official talk that takes place in every romantic relationship. Do you know what it stands for, DTR? Define the relationship. You sit down and you decide where things are going. Have things move from casual to committed? I remember this date I went on in high school. On the very first date, the girl tried to have the DTR talk with me. First date, DTR. I got out of there PDQ. I just ran away.
First of all, you don't have to be a young man for the DTR talk to scare you to death, okay? I just want you to know that. But in every relationship, there really comes a time when you have to define the relationship, right? Where are we going? What are we doing? Are we moving forward? Am I going to get out of it? Do I want it to be the same? What do I want to do? You know, when my wife and I, her name's Jan, when my wife and I started dating, it was sort of casual. You know, just a couple phone calls, go out here or there. But then it started going into a different direction. It was becoming a little bit more serious. And we had to define the relationship. Was this just going to be a dating, or was this going to be something a whole lot more? And we decided that this relationship was going to be exclusive. We were starting to define the direction that we were going in. And then one day, I asked her to marry me. We stand up before a pastor, and we say our vows between God and man, and we leave the church. And we know now we are completely committed to each other. We defined the relationship. It was an exclusive relationship. Now think about it. How happy do you think Janet would be if she was one of many women? I mean, after I woke up from her knocking me out. But in that moment, she knew, and I knew, she had to be the one and only one. I couldn't go to her and say, listen, I'm telling you what, Janet, here's the deal. I will be all yours. I am all in. 1.5 hours on Sunday morning and sometimes on Wednesday night and maybe during the week if I feel like it. Then you will have my complete undivided attention and I'm all in. I'm totally committed to you for that period of time. The rest of the week, I'm going to do what I want to do. Okay? Now, do you think she's going to... Mostly women here. I got to be really careful with this. Do you think she's going to be happy? Do you think she's going to have a good relationship? We're going to have a good marriage? That's the case, really. I don't think so. I don't think she'd feel good. I don't think she'd be there when I needed her if I wasn't there when she needed me. She's not going to feel that I'm completely committed to her if I'm just spending a little bit of time with her on Sunday morning and occasionally on Wednesdays, and maybe when I feel like it during the week. Expect her to be there waiting for me. She don't want to be one of many women. She wants to be the one and only one. But really, isn't that what Jesus wants from us? He wants us to be in a completely committed relationship with Him. He wants completely committed followers. He doesn't want to be one of many things that we follow. He wants to be the one and only thing that we follow. So over the next several weeks, I want all of us, and that, when I say all of us, that includes me, all of us to sort of examine our relationship with Jesus Christ. And I do understand for some of you, this may be like the first or the second date, and you're just not ready for the DTR talk. And I really understand it. And I also appreciate it. But even if there's a little thing inside of you that says Jesus might be who He says He is, I'm not sure yet, but He might be. I'm just asking you to sort of keep coming and keep listening. No pressure. But maybe you're not ready for the DTR talk, but you can just hear, and I pray over the next couple weeks that as you see and hear what Jesus has to say, that you'll find out that He is exactly who He says He is. And that we need to define the relationship. And I think for most of us in this room, most of you come on a pretty regular basis, I think most of you are probably ready for that. You're ready to define your relationship with Jesus Christ. So we're going to look into this invitation from Jesus to follow Him. And we'll be using a verse which clearly lays out what Jesus says. It's the verse that we've already mentioned. It's the one found in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 9, verse 23. Gospel of Luke, chapter 9, verse 23, it says this. Then He said to them all. Now, to them all means to them all. It means to every one of us. The Greek word translated that we use everybody in some translations, actually more appropriate to them all, everybody, means this. Everybody. It's not a trick. He said, he's telling us all, everybody, whoever wants to be my disciple, must deny themselves and take up their cross daily and follow me. So it's not a one-time thing. We do it daily. So I think a lot of us are welcome in this talk. We want to know what it takes. We're ready to move into a different level with our walk with Jesus Christ. We're ready to be that follower he wants us to be. We're ready to move past this casual relationship that we've had, past the convenient relationship maybe we've had, into something a whole lot deeper, a whole lot more devoted, something that's more committed. And I know that maybe some of you aren't, and that's okay. I want you to know that. It's okay. You kind of like the setup that you have with Jesus. And I know that. You know, he's a nice guy. You like church. Gives you something to do on Sunday mornings. You like the coffee. You like the donuts. You like the fellowship. You like the fruit before the service. You like the feeling that when you get here, you just sort of walk in. You like the people that's here. Kind of like what's going on. You like the idea of coming to church. But this idea of being totally committed, this idea of taking it to a different level, that just makes you a little nervous. Maybe you get a little anxious. What if Jesus asked me something, do something I don't like? Maybe you were like I was at one time, and you go into that fight or flight response. And for years, I was in flight. But what we want to do, really, over the next couple weeks, is define our relationship. Where do we stand with Jesus Christ? And here's how we'd like to ask that question. Are you a fan, or are you a follower? Are you a fan of Jesus, or are you a true follower of Jesus? Now, some of you might be asking, well, why would you even ask a question like that? You know, when I first looked at this, when I first started reading the book, when I first started looking at the series, that was the question that I asked myself. You know, the question really didn't carry a whole lot of weight in my heart. It didn't have a whole lot of impact on me. Because we're all followers of Jesus, right? I mean, that's why we're here. That's why we get up on Sunday morning. That's why we come to church, because we want to be followers of Jesus. But I'm just warning you, don't jump to that answer too quickly. Because this question is so familiar, it's so easy to answer, that we all have this tendency to quickly dismiss it, like I did at first. Not because it makes us uncomfortable, not because it's terribly convicting, but we sort of dismiss it because we don't think it's necessary. It's sort of redundant, it's sort of repetitive. I mean, isn't that why we're here? Isn't that why we come? But I want you to know this, it may be the most important question you ever ask yourself. Let me ask you again, are you a fan of Jesus or are you a follower of Jesus? And look, I want to tell you, look at a couple of things that I didn't say, okay? I didn't say, do you go to church? I didn't say, have you ever gone to the altar at the end of the service? I didn't say, do you sign a commitment card? I didn't say, did you repeat a prayer after a pastor at the end of the service? I didn't ask you if you owned a Bible or if you owned more than one Bible or if the King James Version is the only version of the Bible. Then ask if you taught Bible school, children's church, or a board member of a church. And we could go on and on and on, but here's my point. Many of us are really quick to say, yeah, I'm a follower of Jesus. Of course I'm a follower of Jesus. But sometimes I'm not sure we really understand what that question means. So I don't know if you know Inigo Montoya from The Princess Bride. But the quote, Inigo Montoya, I don't think that means what you think it means. What if life came down to this one question? What if life in this world and the next world came down to this one question? What if there really is a heaven and a hell? And what if you and I get to spend eternity depending on how we answer this one question? Whether we get to go to a good place or a bad place, it all comes down to how we answer this one question. So as we go through this series, I've been praying you at least consider the question and really think about it. Am I a fan or a follower of Jesus Christ? Because this may be the most important question you ever answer. Do you believe in Jesus Christ? Or are you a fan of Jesus Christ? Are you ready to really follow Jesus? Or are you ready just simply to believe in him? Are you ready to deny yourself? Are you willing to pick up your cross daily and truly follow Jesus wherever he leads you to be? To do whatever Jesus asks you to do? Are you a fan of Jesus? Or are you a follower of Jesus? The word fan is described as an enthusiastic admirer. And we're all fans of different things. Now, I'm a fan of playing pool. I love to play pool. Not real good at it, but I love to play. But sports is the analogy most people understand. A lot of you in here are sports fans. You watch the games, you watch the races, you have your favorite superstar, you cheer your team on, you cheer on your favorite player. You own the jerseys, you have the t-shirts with their names on it, and I know it because you wear them to church. We understand the concept of being a fan when it comes and it's related to sports, don't we? Here's my concern. And I've said this often. The reason we started the Odyssey Church is because we don't want a lot of fans. But the natural gravitational pull of every single organization is towards insiders, not towards outsiders. And Jesus never told us to stay inside. He always told us to go outside. But the gravitational pull is always towards the insider. So my concern is that one day we're just going to have a whole bunch of comfortable fans of Jesus in our church. And we come to church and we like this Jesus deal. I got my eternal fire insurance. Sort of watch the shows, sing the songs, throw a couple bucks in the place, get our God card checked for the week, and we're okay. And you know, this is no disrespect to wherever you are. I told you, I am not a judge. And I don't condemn anything that you've done, because whatever you've done, I've probably done it twice as much, okay? I am proof living that Jesus Christ can transform my life from in the miry clay and pick him up and bring him out. But a lot of us like it when we talk about the homosexuals and we talk about the adulterers and we talk about the alcoholics, what we think are great big sins. There's a lot of amens coming back from the audience. Everything's fine as long as the pastor don't pick on my sin. We judge when somebody's sin is different than our sin. Everything's going to be okay as long as nobody messes with my life. I'll be a fan of Jesus. Everything's good. But here's the thing. Jesus never cared about having fans. He wants us and will always want us to be completely committed, devoted followers. And to Jesus Christ, sin is sin, and that's why we need a Savior. We can't earn heaven on our own. We need somebody to do it for us. Jesus did it for us. And I know we do this. And the reason I know this, we come to church, is because sometimes it just sort of makes us feel comfortable and makes us good. But when we come to church, we do this. And I know we do it because I still do it. I don't mean to. We're human. We do this stuff. We're getting our cars. And we're like those post-game commentators on ESPN, aren't we? Get in the car. We start talking about the service. Like it was a football game. How did you like the music? Did you see so-and-so? Did you see what she was wearing? Do you hear she did this and he did that? You know, the message was okay, but I think the pastor should have said this or said that. The first half was so long, didn't have a whole lot of action. But the second half was pretty good. And I'm sure glad, I don't have to say amen on this one. I'm sure glad the pastor didn't go into overtime like he did every other week. And then we come back next week and do the same thing again, don't we? But the question is, when you come here and you hear the message, does it really make a difference in your life? Are you just a fan or are you a follower? Are you one of those enthusiastic admirers of Jesus? And if you are, I have to let you know that's not what Jesus is looking for. I think our tendency, because we're all human, and I know this, because I was there. Our tendency is to come together as a bunch of fans once a week of Jesus. It's our human tendency. We sit down in some chairs, and you know, for those of you who've been coming since we began, thank goodness we have more comfortable chairs. Now, we started with metal chairs in the wintertime. Worst idea I ever had in my life. Had to carry a pillow because they were so cold. But we come and we get in our chairs and we open up our bulletins or our Bible or our mobile devices. We applaud when we think it's appropriate. We say amen under our breath occasionally. We leave somehow thinking that as fans, all this was done for us. And if it was good, that's great. If it was bad, shame on them. And the fact of the matter, the audience is our Heavenly Father, Jesus Christ. What have you brought to offer this week? We get in our car, we evaluate the singing, we evaluate the message, we evaluate the sermon, we kind of give the service and song selection a thumbs up or a thumbs down, and then we come back and we do the same thing next week. And I get it. And I really do, because that was me for almost 20 years. I was a great fan, a great admirer of Jesus, and I thought I was doing everything right. But I was like Paul, you know, if anybody knows the story of Paul, Paul was a Pharisee. He was a deeply religious man. He followed all the rules. And one day he meets Jesus on the road to Damascus, and he finds out he'd been doing it all wrong. He was a fan. And when he met Jesus, when he met the risen Savior, he was no longer a fan. He was a true follower. He was all in. I mean, when we're pretty fast, look at kind of look at, you know, when we didn't use Bibles today. Most of the time I have my Bible up here. Like a lot of things, it's somewhere. I just don't know where. I think I left it at my house. But we say the verse and we sort of open it up and then we look around and see if I got there faster than everybody else. You know, got them sword drills keeping on going. Being a fan can feel really, really good, and I know it because I was a fan for a long time. We can feel good about ourselves because we're the great admirers of Jesus Christ. But Jesus never really cared about having fans. That's where I was for most of my Christian experience. But I want so much more now. I want to make a difference in people's lives. That's why I'm here. I want to be a true disciple of Jesus Christ. Does it mean I'm perfect? Does it mean that I always get it right? Not at all. I'm human. I'll tell you, I probably get more wrong than I get right. But I'll tell you what I do then. I have a heart for lost souls. I have a heart for people. I love God's people. Now, I'm a type A personality, though. You know, I have great passion to see this church do what the church is doing. Sometimes in that passion, I sort of mess it up. I get carried away. But it's only because I know most of the people around me, most of the people around you, people that I love that are in my family, people that I love that are outside my family, people that you love, are headed on a very wide road to a place we call hell. And if we don't do something about it, we don't do something to reach them with the saving product of Jesus Christ, that's exactly where they're going to end up. I truly desire to follow Jesus wherever he takes me. And I want the same thing for you. And we could sit back and do nothing. It would be so much easier. We've had a lot of success. It may not look like it today, but we've had a lot of success over the last year since we launched back in September of 2014. We're not even 2 years old yet, but we've started new ministries. We've reached out to the community. We're very active in the ecumenical society. We get a chance to go to many other churches. We have a great youth group. In fact, our youth group normally has more people on Friday nights than our services do on half Sunday night. Our Wednesday night group is growing huge. So we're having all these things, and we can just sit back and say, you know, been hard, let's take it easy for a little while. But I'm going to tell you, that's a fan. That's not a follower. And that's why I do what I do. And there's some people that are really big fans. You know, for years, I was the biggest fan in the world. I knew all the songs. I knew all the stories in the Bible. And I knew the scriptures. And I even did a couple things to help out in the church. But I wasn't committed enough to deny myself. So today, are you a fan or a fan? Are you committed enough to actually deny yourself for Jesus Christ? To let him influence the decisions you make every single day and every area of your life? Because unless we let Jesus into our hearts and let him influence our lives, we're just fans and we're just cheering Jesus on. Followers are truly committed to Jesus and they're willing to sacrifice. What are you willing to sacrifice to be a follower of Jesus Christ? And I've been praying, every one of us, including me, like I said, that we'll take this serious, and for the next 6 weeks, we'll sacrifice and we'll deny ourselves and we'll come out not only on Sunday mornings, but Wednesday nights. Because if this question is really this important, and it could determine where we spend all of eternity, isn't it worth at least 6 Sundays and 6 Wednesdays to find out where we stand with our Creator? This series should really challenge you. It should define your relationship, and if done correctly and intentionally, you're going to learn something about yourself. You're going to learn something about your relationship with God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. If we'll be really honest, if we'll truly search our hearts and begin to find our relationship with Jesus Christ, there are 3 questions for you to answer this morning. I want you to think about them. I want you to think about it before you answer, because God already knows your heart. You can't fool him, but sometimes we can fool ourselves. So don't try to fool God, and don't try to fool yourself. And the first question is this. Why are you here this morning? Why are you here every morning? Why do you come to church? Because if you read through the gospel, at different points in Jesus' ministry, he'd draw a line in the sand, and he'd separate the fan from the followers. And maybe you remember the account of Jesus and the miracle feeding of the 5,000 men, plus their wives and their children. Jesus at the height of his ministry. Very popular. He could have kept going like he was. He was working the miracles. He just provided food for 5,000 men, plus their wives and their children. Some people say there were as many as 25,000 to 40,000 people there that day. He had 5 loaves of bread, 2 fish. He feeds them all, and everybody's happy. There's a lot of people in the crowd, and they're going wherever Jesus goes. But it's almost as Jesus, right after that, has this epiphany. He begins to realize why people are following. So Jesus stands up in front of this large crowd, and he says, you know what? Some of you here today are not following me for who I am. You're following me for what I do for you. Basically, what he was saying was, you're coming here. He said miraculous sign, but he basically said, you're coming here to see the show, and you're coming here for the free food. And that's really the only reason that you're coming. And from now on, no more free food and no more show. Because I want to know who's here for me and who's here for what I can do for them. For those who are coming just for what I can do for them, and nothing more than a fan. But those who are coming for who I am, you're the followers. They're the ones that I want. Most of the people in that crowd, that they could care less about this life-changing message that Jesus was talking about. They were just there to see a miracle. They were just there to get some food from Jesus. So the question becomes this morning is, why are you here? What is your because? Are you feeling like? I'm here because. Are you here because you have a heart to worship God? Are you here because you have a heart for lost souls? Are you here just to have some place to go on Sunday morning because you feel like what you ought to do? It's because you think the seats are comfortable, people are nice, we like the kind of music, we like the chit-chat, kids can come here, and we got a good children program that's starting up. Is that why you're here? Question is, it's sooner or later, Jesus is going to do the same thing to you that he did to the crowds, and he's going to ask you to define your relationship. See, in this passage found in the Gospel of John chapter 6, and if you've never read the miracle of the 5,000, I challenge you to read the whole chapter of John chapter 6. It is a wonderful, wonderful story. It's a great account. Read the entire book. Jesus really challenges his fans to go into a much more deeper, intimate relationship with him. But I want you to look at what happens in John chapter 6, verse 66. This is what we read. When Jesus challenges his fans to become a true follower, this is what John writes. From this time, many of his disciples turned back and no longer followed him. A lot of them simply went home because Jesus is saying, in effect, let's define what we got going on here. And what he offered wasn't what they wanted. Maybe, and I hope this isn't true, maybe some people have been coming here for a while. You understand that things are going on. You've been coming here. You've been looking at the miracle. Maybe more for the show, more for what Jesus can do for you than who he is. And Jesus has come to a point where he's saying, let's define this relationship we have together. Why you're here? I'm here because you feel on the back. Jesus is here for a reason. And he tells us in his word why he's here. Jesus is here because he wants you and he wants me to have a deep, deep, deep relationship with him. An intimate relationship with him. Jesus wants us to love him like he loves us. And he loves us with all his heart. And he wants us to love him with all our heart. He says, don't follow me for what you can get out of me. Follow me because I got this life-changing message for you. You know, a great part about the message of Jesus Christ is whether you believe in him or you don't believe in him, if you follow what he says, you will have a better life in this world. If you do the things Jesus says, you will have better health. You will have better finances. You will have better relationships. At least in this world. But Jesus says, I want to have a personal, intimate relationship with you. But some of us, you know, we just don't like to hear that because we think it's all about us. Not all about Jesus, but as we heard in that song, The Heart of Worship this morning, it's always all about Jesus. Jesus, I came and I denied myself. I picked up my cross for you and I died for you. Now that's what I want you to do for me. Now I don't mean die physically. What he's saying is die to self and live for him. He tells us to live for the one who died for him or died for us. So the first question is, why are we here this morning? Is it where you ought to be on Sunday mornings? Is that why you come? Or is it so you can be seen in church? You know, I have to admit, I was a businessman one time. And I think sometimes I was going to church because I wanted people to think I was this completely committed follower of Jesus. And if I was in church, they'd think I was this great Christian. Is it simply keep peace in your home? Your parents expect you to come. And Bryce and I went on this weekend, and you probably heard this analogy before. Pastor used it and just refreshed my memory. He said, man, I had a drug problem when I was a kid. My parents drove me to church on Sunday morning. My parents drove me to church on Sunday night. My parents drove me to church on Wednesday evenings. I was drugged to church almost every day, and it was not a question as to whether we were going to church. I was going to church. Why you come? Just to make it easier? Or maybe it's your wife, your husband, or your significant other that's expecting you to come to church with them. So you can come and see who else is there and what they're wearing and what they're doing and what they're saying and catch up on the latest gospel. Is that a habit? And I see that a lot. Not really being fed, you're just coming because you're coming so long you just don't know what else to do. Don't know where else to go. You know the routine, you become comfortable, and you're just a great fan. I like coming, but you know, being committed in every area of my life, are you crazy? Jesus, I just don't know about all that. I ain't got time for all that. Or have you done as Jesus commanded? If anyone would come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life will save it. Are you here to truly worship your Lord and Savior and to follow him, to deny yourself and to come after him, to pick up your cross daily and follow him wherever he leads you? Let him have control over your life, over every single area. So the first question is, why are you here? The second question is this. Second question is, are you all in? You see, being a follower of Jesus does require complete commitment. Follower of Jesus will do whatever it takes to follow Jesus. Not absolutely loyal, completely committed. And most of us don't do very well with absolute commitment, do we? And I think we prefer selective commitment. And if I put it simply and I put it frankly, we have a tendency to customize our Christianity, don't we? We look at our relationship with Jesus and said, I'm going to follow you, Jesus, but I'm sort of going to kind of pick and choose the areas I'm going to follow you in. We end up saying, Jesus, you know, I'm going to follow you, but you know that person that hurt me so bad? I'm not going to forgive that person. I'm not going to let go of that bitterness. I mean, I deserve that. You know what they did to me? I know your word says forgive, but I can't forgive. I'm not going to forgive. Jesus, I'll follow you, but don't you dare talk to me about my money. I work hard for my money. My money is my money. I'll follow you. That's one area of my life that you don't have any control over. Jesus, I'll follow you, but don't you look at what I watch on TV. Don't you look at what I watch on the internet, okay? Everybody else is doing nothing wrong with it. We even talk about it at church sometimes when we walk in the door. Everybody else is doing, don't talk to me about what I watch on TV. What about this one I see in today's world? Jesus, don't you talk to me about my carnal desires. But I'll follow you. But in this world, sex outside of message, just out of wedlock, is just simply expected. It's just normal. Don't tell me to abstain from my sexual desires. I can't help the fact that I got all these desires. I mean, do exactly what Adam did. Besides, you're the one who created me this way. Blame it on God. I'll follow you, Jesus. That won't stop me from getting what I want. Jesus, don't you come to work with me. Work is work, okay? You're not invited when I go out with my friends. Don't watch what I do when I'm home by myself, okay? We like to have this customized Christianity. We'll follow Jesus, but only in the areas where we're really comfortable following Jesus. And only in the areas that we agree with him in. I'm a Christian, but I'm not all in. I don't care what the scripture says. I'm not comfortable with all that, Jesus. You're just going to have to understand. And if that's you, I just have to be the bearer of that news and tell you, according to the scriptures, according to Jesus Christ, you're not a follower. You're just simply a fan. And that's not what Jesus is looking for. There's not an option of selective commitment. It's not a possibility. There's no bargaining, no bartering, no finagling. When you decide to become a follower of Christ, you got to go all in. And fans, they don't like the idea of going all in. They're not wild about making sacrifices or about having to deny themselves of something they desire or something they want. In the 14th chapter of the Gospel of Luke, Jesus has another one of those DTR talks. And I think he is doing what no pastor in the world would do today. Really don't think they would. He begins to thin the crowds. He begins to take some people out of the crowds. He starts to challenge his fans, and they start to fear. And you know what? As they start to leave him, the strange part about the scriptures are, not once does Jesus follow him. Somebody leaves the church today, and we do everything we can to get them to come back to the church. But when somebody walked away from Jesus, Jesus was hurt. He was sad. But he didn't go chasing after them. He let them make the decision. When Jesus said, "Would anybody come after me? They must deny himself and take up his cross and follow me." At this point in Jesus' ministry, he was at the top of his popularity. Word had spread about this teacher, this rabbi, who had made the lame walk, the blind see. He'd taken funeral processions and turned them into family reunions by raising the dead. People were coming all over the hillsides to see Jesus. And in Luke 14:25, Luke says the large crowds were traveling with Jesus. See, for a while, it seemed like Jesus was okay with the large crowd. In today's world, if you've got a megachurch, are you going to start thinning out the crowds? Saying, those of you that are just fans, please do. Yeah. But it doesn't seem like he minds that they were coming to see the miracles. This is one of the things we base our church on. We want people to come in and experience a good time. We want the food out there. We want the fellowship. We want you to have the experience. And we want it to be good so you bring other people back. But when it comes down to talking about the message, you got to hear the whole counsel of the gospel. It's not doing you any good, and I'm not doing my job and what God has required of me.
Amen.
So Jesus welcomes the people that were curious. We welcome the people that are curious, because that's how it starts out, isn't it? We were all curious. We all wanted that. But for some of us, as we learned and found out Jesus was exactly who he says he was, there was a time we had to define the relationship. Jesus begins to thin out the crowds. He begins to find out who's there for his teaching, who wanted his power, who wanted his strength. He does the same thing today. Jesus welcomes the seekers, but sooner or later, he says, hey, we got to define this relationship. He draws this line in the sand. He said, I wonder where he's standing. Because ultimately, I have to keep remembering this. It's not about the number of people who come to Odyssey Church. It's about the level of the commitment of the people who come to the Odyssey Church.
Amen.
So if we got two people here and they're truly committed, that's okay. If we had 200 here and none of them were committed, that's not okay. But here's what I know. The more we become committed, the more we'll bring other seekers in. The more they become committed, the larger the church. Living organisms grow. God always says the church is some form of living. Jesus, he says, it's time. Have you come to church for the miracle and the healing show? Have you come for the free food? Do you just want to hear a motivational speaker? So the crowd begins getting separated into two groups, the fans and the followers. And Luke 25:27 said, this is how Jesus says he separated the two groups. How he separated the fans from the Father. Since large crowds were traveling with Jesus, and turning to them, he said, if anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and mother, his wife and children, his brothers and sisters, yes, even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. Now, I need you to know, he wasn't talking about actually hating your mom and dad. That would be breaking the fifth commandment, right? What he's saying is, in comparison to your love for me, it should seem like you. He's not telling you to hate anybody. And that's not the message of Jesus. But he says, anyone who does not carry his cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. Can't be. Not couldn't be. Couldn't, shouldn't be. Can't be. But pastor preached that message today. This is probably what he said. He'd say something like this. You know, a large crowd was following Jesus. And he turned to them and said, what a great crowd we have here today. I want every one of you to go home and invite somebody to come back tonight. Because we're going to have some live entertainment. We're going to have all the loaves and all the fishes you can eat. We're going to have a water to wine booth, so bring a designated driver just in case. And whoever invites the most friends gets a free meal. Let's pack this place. That's not what Jesus does. He begins to thin the crowd. They begin to tell, listen, you either want to follow me and give up everything, or you can go home. If you can't follow me and sacrifice and be what you want me to be, you can't be my disciple. Jesus says, anyone who comes to me must do that. You can't take a deep breath and say, you know, Jesus, I was talking to this group and I'm saying, now what he's saying. He's the word there, anyone means anyone. We don't pick up our cross daily and sacrifice and follow Jesus. Jesus says you can't be his disciple. So the question becomes this, is that the type of follower I want to be? Do I really want to be a follower or do I simply like to be a fan? Because being a fan is so much easier. Because a fan, in reality, isn't really a follower at all. Fan is just cheering Jesus on. That's easy. But to be a follower of Jesus, you have to be all in, and that's hard. And Jesus even tells us in the scriptures, and we miss this some, he said, count the cost before you follow me. It will cost you something. Just don't hear a lot of that preaching in today's world. I don't want to be a fan of Jesus. I want to be a true follower of Jesus. And a follower has to make sacrifices. You can't serve Jesus just when it's comfortable for you. You can't serve Jesus just when it's convenient for you. You have to sometimes deny yourself. Sometimes you don't get to do what you want to do. Sometimes you have to do what God calls you to do. Are you all in? But really, if you answered the first question truthfully, why are you here? Then it's going to be pretty easy to figure out why, if you're all in. If you aren't here for the right reasons, chances are you aren't willing to go all in. So defining the relationship with Jesus, we've asked one question. First question was, why are you here? Second question is, are you all in? And the third question is this, have you made it your own? See, I started going to church when I was a kid because mom and dad made me go to church. I started going to church when I was a little bit older because it was the right thing to do and I had kids and I wanted to teach them. Maybe some of you started coming to church because you got a girlfriend or a boyfriend and they want you to come to church, so you just like to appease them and make them happy. Maybe you come because you like it when you come, you feel good about yourself. You come because it appeases somebody else, it makes them happy. And really, for those of us who grew up in church, just in order to make somebody else's, it can be really easy to become a fan. I remember when my daughter Chelsea was about 4 years old, and I'll tell you how long ago this was. She turns 29 this year. But I worked for a car dealership. I worked for a Toyota dealership. And in my position, in my capacity, the good thing about it is I could pick out any car I want and drive it. But she loved to go with me and pick up a bright red convertible, bright red Toyota Celica convertible with a black top. We would put the top down, and her favorite thing in the world to do was put in an Aerosmith CD. 4 years old, and sing "Walk This Way" to the top of her lungs. I mean, she was all in with Aerosmith, and she knew every single word. And yet, people looking at us down the road, this 4 year old singing every word to "Walk This Way." She was in kindergarten when she made me a keychain. And it said, head banging, walk this way, and a picture of a Toyota convertible, me and her in there singing. So in a way, I became a fan of Aerosmith to make my daughter happy. You know, we do the same thing in church a lot of times, don't we? We come to appease someone else, and pretty soon we just get into the flow of things. We know most of the songs, we even recognize the stories, we recognize the teachings, and we're just sort of fans of Jesus because somebody else is and they want us to do it. But I want you to know that that is probably the most dangerous place that you can be. If your faith isn't your own, you aren't pursuing a relationship with Jesus, and you keep coming week after week and begin to create a faith that was somebody else's in the first place, you begin to numb yourself to the real thing. Begin to numb yourself to real faith, and you become comfortable with a few songs and a few favorite verses, none of which requires any sacrifice or personal change. You have to make your faith your own. Jesus is not looking at a relationship between you and your mom or you and your spouse. He's looking for this deep, intimate relationship between you and him. Personal relationship. This is about you and Jesus. Jesus doesn't want part of you. He wants all of you. Jesus isn't looking for fans. He wants us to define our relationship. And he tells us over and over and over in his word, I love you more than you can ever imagine or even believe. I gave up my life for you. And I want you to live for the one who died for you. So where are we today? Are we a fan or are we a follower? We need to begin to define the relationship you have with Jesus Christ. Why are you here? Are you all in? Have you made it your own? Begin to search your heart these next few weeks as we ask this question. Are you a follower of Jesus or are you a fan of Jesus?